Hello, and welcome to this practical tutorial on building and evaluating LLM apps. In this video series, we will show how to build different apps with LLM and evaluate them. We'll start from classification task. Imagine you need to build a chatbot for a travel company where users send a ton of different messages on bookings and cancellations. Your task is to classify them by topic. In fact, this task can be solved with LLMs, and generally, even in complex AI agents, the first step is to classify the user's intent and then decide what prompt or what tool is the best to do the job. Such kind of tasks are often solved by LLMs. But to make it more fun, in this video we will also train the traditional machine learning model, and we'll see who wins. Let's get started. As you can see now, I work from my local Jupyter notebook. During this tutorial, we are going to use OpenAI as well as Evidently. For both tools, you would need to have your API keys. I already get my, and I set it up as environment variable, and I suggest you do the same if you work in Jupyter notebook, or you can use secrets if you go for collab. First of all, let's get started from a couple of imports. I'm going to use Pandas and scikit-learn. And also we have a very interesting classification problem. It's multi-class classification. We are going to classify text inputs into different groups. This is the booking problem statement. We already have this dataset uploaded to Evidently course GitHub, and I'm going to access it through Pandas. Yeah, I just got it. And let's preview our dataset. So we have short queries, you can preview it right there, and they have different labels. Basically, you have five labels there, and the task is to classify them correctly. Let us take a look at the size of our dataset. Well, it's not huge, right? We have two columns, the input text and the label, and it's 200 rows. So I would like to start from more like traditional approach and first train logistic regression model so that we can see the quality of a baseline, and then we are going to apply zero-shot learning so that we can compare which approach works the best and maybe decide which suits more to our use case. So let me start from the splitting data into two parts, training and testing. I'm doing it with help of scikit-learn trend test split, and I believe for our case it will be enough if we just set like 10% our data to test and all the rest will be training. And I use random states so that we can do reproducible experiments. Basically, if you would need to train the real classification model, you would need to use some cross-validation and hyperparameter tuning so that you can get the best possible models. But here, we're just doing it for the experimental purpose, so it's not a tutorial on training classification models. Having this in mind, I'm just splitting my data into two parts, and I will train a single logistic regression model on top of training data and then apply it to the testing data. So that's more or less my plan. In order to train logistic regression, I would need to preprocess my text a little bit because I cannot just train model on top of the raw text data. So for doing that, I'm going to use count vectorizer from scikit-learn free instruction text. It will help me to calculate some statistics over words present in my short queries and then use those statistics, like how many times this word presented in my text, in order to like train the model on top of numerical vectors. So yes, and also I'm going to import the logistic regression model itself so that I can use it and an accuracy score to shortly and quickly assess the quality of my models. Here we go, and let's create the vectorizer object. That's basically a preprocessor which helps us to transform raw text into numerical vectors. First, I would need to feed it on top of my training data, and then transform my training data into vectors, and then I'm also going to transform my testing data so that I can use both with model. Here we go, and let's create a model. It's basic logistic regression with the random state so that we can have reproducible results, and I also limit max iterations. Yeah, now I have an object. Then, well, let's feed it. So I applied to vectorized train, and I'm gonna use labels as well. And after I train my model, I'm going to generate some prediction. So first for training data, and then for testing data as well. This should be super fast, and you can see that, well, it's extremely fast and no tokens involved. So it's also cheap. So now I have my predictions. I also got labels and I can calculate accuracy. And it's fine to use accuracy score here because it's not like binary classification. It's multi-class, it's well balanced, I would say. So we can apply the accuracy score here and be safe with that. And you can see that it's perfectly done on training data. Well, it's expected, kinda. Let's see on testing data. Well, you can see that the score is like 80%. So in 80% of cases, we had the label correctly, which might be good for multi-class classification. But to understand it better, you would need to build like a proper report so that you can see other classification quality metrics like precision, recall, or F-score. Else, it would be nice to see confusion metrics so that we understand how good we are for each particular class. So let's do that. For helping us to build the proper report, we're going to use Evidently. In order to use Evidently, we would need to import a couple of things from Evidently, but I believe you already know the basic API. So it's dataset, data definition, report, and multi-class classification. I believe we touched this point in previous videos, so probably I do not need to stop here. I imported that, and now let's build up our data frame, because for Evidently we need to set up a dataset, and well, data frame will be a basis for this dataset. So I would create the pandas data frame with the label equal to our test labels. Then I'm going to use test predictions we just generated with help of logistic regression model and the queries itself, which are in xtest. And I use dot values in both cases here, just because I don't want to store original indexes. I just don't need it. Yep. Let's preview our data frame. And here it is. So we can see queries, predicted labels, and labels. And well, in most cases, it's similar, but sometimes we have some errors. So yeah, like here. But I would say that actually it's a good question. What is our expectations for ideal model? Because queries are pretty short and it's all related to booking, right? So it's not a big deal to like mistake something to a booking, but yeah. It needs to be properly analyzed with help of a report and the raw data analysis. So let's continue with our report. As promised, we would need to start from the dataset and data definition. In our case, data definition helps to understand how to parse data correctly. And well, we have a single text column with query, and then we need to tell Evidently that we are working with multi-class classification problem, and target and predicted labels are not just columns, it's target and prediction in our case. So let's mark it like this, with help of multi-class classification. Let me run it. And yeah, now I have my data definition ready. So I can create a data set, and I'm going to create it from data frame and data definition. Here we go. So now I have everything to build up a report. For doing that, I use report object, it's here, and I need to specify some metrics. As promised, in this case, we are going to go for classification preset. Here we go. And in order to get some values, we need to run this. Yeah, it's ready. So I'm intrigued. Why not to preview it right there inside of Jupyter notebook? And here is our report. So we can see the accuracy exactly as it was calculated before, 80%. And also we can see precision, recall, and F-score. Well, looks actually not bad for multi-class classification problem. Here is your confusion matrix, and if you're interested, you can see and compare the model's mistakes for different class. Well, interesting, right? And also you can have the metrics calculated for each class independently. Well, here we have our baseline, it's pretty nice. Let's load those results to Evidently Cloud so that we can store it and access it later, and then we'll try to apply large language model to solve the same problem. In order to load my report to Evidently Cloud, I would need to create a client. So let me import Cloud Workspace, and then I'm going to create a client. And you can see that there is no information about Evidently API key. This is like that because I have it set up as my environment variable. So if you did not do that, you would need to specify it right there as well. Yeah, so in Evidently, we organize our work in projects. So first of all, I would need to create a project or access one if I already created it, but I did not. So I would call it classification task, LLM course, and I would store it in my personal organization. Here is an organization ID. In order to get your organization ID, you're going to need to access Evidently in the UI and just copy it from there. So let me create the project, and now as I already have project, so let me access the cloud and see whether it's created. Yeah, so here it is, exactly as we call it. So far it's empty, but yeah. Now it's time to go back to our Jupyter notebook and with help of command add run, load our report there. And I'm also gonna use include data true so that we also load our data set. Here we go. Let's quickly see if it's loaded correctly. I do not expect any problems there, but let's see. Yeah, here we go. Here is a single report. If I hit explore button, I will be able to see the same results. Very nice. And here is my data set as well. So if I need to understand some particular cases better, I can read label, predicted label, and the text itself. So it's very useful for the analysis. Okay, looks like we're done with our baseline and we can move on to the short classification. For doing that, I'm going to import OpenAI and create a client. Well, the name client is already occupied, so it's going to be a client. So now, in order to apply zero-shot learning, I'm going to use OpenAI responses create API. Let me quickly check the syntax so that later I can build a function based on that. And syntax is pretty nice and simple. So I have instructions. That's the place where I can write something that we called system prompt before, so the general instruction for our model. I can select the model itself. Here I go for GPT-4o mini and the input data, right? So it's my test question. I'm just asking what is the latest version of GPT-4 model. Let us check the syntax. I think it's very useful if you're going to apply something for the whole dataset. First preview if you have it correctly. Yeah, I'm happy with the output. Yeah, well, it doesn't have an access to internet, so that's the output, but it's kind of okay. So now I'm going to implement very similar function based on this responses API. I'm going to add some system prompt instructions and I will apply this query to the whole dataset, to the label queries, so that it uses every single row as the input and generate the prediction label for me. So my instruction will be pretty straightforward. So I tell that it's a customer support assistant trained to classify incoming booking-related support messages. And then I just have information about every single class, like booking, payment, policy, technical, and escalation. And even based on those descriptions, you can see that it's kind of intersecting, right? Because, well, technical can be as well related to booking, which can be kind of escalation, right? So it's going to be hard to come up with the ideal model, but let's try. I think those instructions makes a total sense, right? And yeah, I think it's going to be nice if we just apply this prompt to our data. So again, I'm going to first apply it to a single row. So our first query in our test dataset is please assist with booking confirmation. Didn't get email? Well, pretty rough. I'm interested if you can get kind of guess the class. I would say it's also like technical or escalation or booking. I mean, well, yeah, it's not that clear. Yeah, it's booking. Okay, so now let's try and see what our model will tell us. So I'm going to apply it to the same query and see the output booking. So at least on top of this case, it's correct. So I like the format of my output and let me wrap this code into function. I'm going to use client, model, and input as input parameters, right? And here is the same response. So I will place here instruction, model, and input, and return an output. So pretty straightforward implementation. And again, it's not like production grade code, we are just experimenting. Here we go. Now let's generate some output here. I'm using list comprehension, so I'm just generate the list with predictions. And well, it does take some time because we apply large language model to every single input. Let's wait a bit. I almost lost my patience there. Okay, so let's see the list of the predicted labels. Yeah, looks fine. And let's quickly assess the quality because I just cannot wait. I want to see the numbers. And yeah, it's already better than the logistic regression. Nice. So why not to create a data frame with the result? I'm going to have here label, queries, and new predicted labels generated with LLM. Here we go. So here I can reuse my existing data definition because the structure of the dataset is quite same. And that's how I can start working with the experiments. I mean, I have a baseline. Now I created like the second approach. And in order to like understand and compare the quality, maybe later decide on the best approach for the problem statement, what I need is to create a report. And now I need tag because actually I have more than a single run. In this case, I used OpenAI 4.0 mini. So let it be tag. And instead of browsing my report here, I'm going to send it to Evidently as well. Wonderful. Also, actually, we can explore different models in OpenAI because it's also have now GPT 4.1. Why not to add one more iteration? Because might be, who knows, maybe we will be able to achieve even better quality. Anyway, it's very fast. Well, actually, it's not. It's an experiment which you can code really fast. So let me add it as well because I'm just curious to see how good it is. Yeah, it's done. So let's quickly assess the numbers. Well, similar, but it's just accuracy. We have much more metrics. So let me generate a data frame with prediction, label, and query. I'm also going to create a dataset for Evidently so that we can generate a report. Now we stack OpenAI 4.1. And let us also send it to Evidently. Now we have everything loaded to Evidently, so let's access our project. I'm going to go back to reports to check if we have everything. And yeah, it's all loaded, it's all here. So now I suggest us to take a look at comparison option in Evidently, and if we hit all the checkboxes for our reports to compare, and here I'm going to compare all reports because it's all related to the same problem statement, I can hit button compare here, and here we go. So basically now we can compare all our reports in terms of metrics, like pure numbers, and see what approach looks better for our problem statement. For instance, here, let us start from accuracy score, right? So we remember that for our baseline logistic regression, we had 80%, 0.8, here it is. And then we had same for zero-shot learning with different models. We also have precision and recall, and you can see that most or even all of metrics are actually the same. So we can conclude that the upgrade from GPT 4.0 mini to GPT 4.1 didn't really help a lot. So this is a convenient interface where you can compare all the metrics and decide what approach you like better. And basically after you selected one, for instance, GPT 4.0 mini looks really good here. You can go back to reports and explore the single report in more details. So actually here we have confusion matrix. Right, we can understand where we made a mistake and why it has happened. And also, if you're interested, you can go directly to the dataset and assess all the examples so that you can understand what has happened and maybe agree or disagree with the result, maybe add some comment for future experiments and share it with developers. That's all I wanted to share with you in this tutorial. Now you know how you can create a report with help of Evidently, send it to the cloud, and access comparison tab so that you can compare results quickly and understand which approach looks better, at least from the quality metrics point of view.